friends. The keynote speaker for the 32nd anniversary celebration is a Renaissance man, in many ways, and is a lifelong learner. He holds some 10 degrees. Now, I know how much reading it took to attain my master's from Johns Hopkins University. I have no idea how anybody does 10 degrees. And when I was finished studying for the ministry, I swore I'm not reading another book. But I think it's because he has all of the deep learnings of humankind, Tertullian, Hebrew, and Amharic, and Sanskrit, all across his chest. I think he has him in the mirror in the exam. No. Be serious. His eclectic academic career and spiritual path have aided him in transforming his own life while also serving as an catalyst to assist others in transforming their own lives. He did some of that work with us yesterday. Wonderful. Our speaker is an ordained interfaith, interspiritual, and youth minister and serves on the board of directors of a World Alliance of International Interfaith Clergy. He's a certified holistic life coach, a certified teacher of American psychology, and he's a professional speaker, facilitator of workshops and classes and such. He's the founder, artistic director, and performing member of BELIE, an American Sign Language Theatrical Performance Company. He's founder and senior teacher of the Guangyang He's also a Reiki master, teacher and practitioner, freelance American Sign Language interpreter, specializing in theatrical and musical interpreting, a contributing writer with Examiner.com as the Washington, D.C. Youth Examiner. He's the author of two books, Visual Music, Interpreting Songs in American Sign Language, and Moving Mountains, The Journey of Transformation. He has several works in production related to living fully as a spiritual warrior, building the life you deserve, and deserving and living from that place of power that is inherently always as a divine heritage. Now, I can take you on to our past, but friends, let us give our guest speaker, the Reverend Dr. Raymond.
There's a particular word
that is beginning the process of. What is that called? Proposal, so that the two people can be prior engaged. So, sorry for this disclaimer. I'm a little bit of a Star Trek, Star Wars comic book nerd, and let you know this now. There's this Star Trek series called Star Trek: The Next Generation, and the captain of the ship is Jean-Luc Picard. And prior to the ship moving forward into whatever direction it is going, he would say one particular thing. Anyone know what that is? Engage. Meaning, begin. It is time to start. It is time to move. It is time to grow. And engagement is a promise that I will step forward into this new path of living, moving, and having my beingness as a married person. Many years ago, someone chose to engage, to promise, to build and move forward this community. And all of you witnessed this wedding of sorts, this engagement of sorts. If not, this wouldn't be here. You wouldn't be here. So let's think about this for a second. Because I'm told that you are now beginning a new mission-driven initiative, thriving ministry. But the idea is, can we thrive if the individuals don't thrive? Because if every seat in here was empty every Sunday, what happens to the ministry? See, the ministry is not this building. It is not any one individual. The ministry is every single one of you, all coming together. Now, if this is the case, then we have to ask ourselves, am I committed to the ministry? Am I committed to this philosophy? Am I committed to also be an expression of the beloved? Am I committed to doing whatever work I need to do to thrive in my own life? See, the idea is, suppose Reverend John is a farmer, and he has several bags of seeds, and I mean they're good seeds, and he has this rich and fertile soil to plant the seeds in, and he invites people to come to his property and join in and plant their seeds and build this, you know, sowing seeds and build this ripe and plentiful harvest. But people don't come and plant their seeds. They hold on to them, or they squander them. What happens to the farm? What happens to the harvest? What happens when you have this great potential to plant, to nourish, to feed, but you withhold? How many people in here have someone that you love, someone that you care about, someone you adore, whether that's a parent, a friend, a child, or someone that you love? And if you don't raise your hand, then I offer myself love for you. Everybody should love somebody. I love you. Everybody should love somebody. So, there's someone you love. Do you get stingy with your love and withhold it from them? Or do you love them so much that when they leave, they smell your love on them? Like you hug them. It was mentioned, because yesterday at the workshop, I mentioned this idea of not simply being grateful, but being gratitude personified. Because if we talk about God, and sometimes we still talk about God in a way that God is this anthropomorphic thing, you know, and God loves us. But there's another little comma and some other stuff where God is love showing up in, through, and as us. So it's not just about being loving or receiving love, but it's about standing and knowing that from the top of our heads to the soles of our feet, we are love given human form. In the same way, so we know water, right? Anybody know what the chemical compound of water is? H2O, right? So there's H2O, and H2O can show up as a solid, flesh, as a liquid, blood, and as a gas, So what if God is no different in terms of God showing up? H2O is a chemical compound. You can't drink H2O. You drink what H2O becomes. But H2O, being the divine God, shows up in the flesh. But the flesh is no different than H2O. It's just a physical demonstration of that principle. Blood flowing through water, H2O. Breath, breathing in and out. We don't, and I said yesterday, we're not breathing ourselves. We don't say inhale, exhale, because if we did, we'd pass out. Like I told folks yesterday, I love donuts. I love donuts. If you love me, you'll never mind. I love donuts. Love them. But if I had to focus on eating a donut and breathing, I'm going to go there. Every time I'm going to pass out because I'm going to breathe. Right? But we are being breathed. But we have to surrender because we can choose. When we get stressed or angry, the manner in which we breathe changes. We huff and we puff and we try to blow stuff down instead of simply surrendering, allowing ourselves to be breathed. In order to thrive, to be that which Spirit is, thrive, because God thrives, period. There is no stagnation in that which we call the universe, Spirit, or Source. So the moment we stand and surrender and allow, release, let go and let that which God is, then we have to also thrive. But sometimes we hold on to stuff. We're like, but wait a minute. I've got 5 seeds. What if they don't grow? What if they don't grow? Like, and we hold on because we're afraid. But you have to let go. We don't grow once it plants. We don't grow it. We plant it and we trust. We let go of the seeds into the rich soil. And we trust that there is a divine principle called nature, called Mother Nature, that knows sunlight and water and fertilizer and the right and perfect bugs that are going to do what they need to do so those seeds can crack open and grow. Why are we still holding on to our lives as if there are seeds not ready to be broken open, not ready to flourish and grow? In order to thrive, in order for this ministry to truly thrive based upon its mission, everyone in here must engage in the same way you engage another human being for marriage. Now, there are some people who will say, so the troops came and they engaged the enemy. It's still the same thing. To enter into, for them, it's to enter into this conflict. However, in warfare, if someone says, that side is going to lose, you are not committed. When you have a team that you are rooting for the World Cup or anything, are you committed to your team? You're not playing the game, but do you commit to whatever team you are? You committed to them? Now, some of us are, but some of us, when our team loses, we go to a different team, and that's all well and good. It's all well and good. But the point is, how committed are you? So in the beginning, in your program, you read several legalese, correct? So we say, we believe the ultimate goal of life to be complete emancipation from all discord of every nature. Do you believe that? Because see, the thing is, if you're going to read it, are you engaged in the process that makes it come true? Are you engaged in the process that says, whenever discord shows up in my life, discord of any nature? Oh, and for those, raise your hand if you were here at the workshop yesterday. Now, there was an important piece of information I forgot to give you, so put your hands down. So, what I told them yesterday was, recently I had an MRI done, found out that I'm experiencing a herniated disc in my neck, and that the MRI showed that there is a certain level of bleeding that was on my spine, right? And then the doctor said, you know, that all is well and everything is good. So, but the herniated disc, the pain related to it, the pain is occasionally still there. But how do I engage in the discord, the discomfort of, ow, I have to relax. I surrender and feel it. Because the more I try to deny it, the more I tense up, and the more it hurts. But the moment I surrender and say, in this moment right here, right now, there is nothing for me to do. This is where I feel the pain and breathe and allow myself to be breathed. What is there for me to do? Pray, meditate, treat. Do the stretches and things the physical therapist gave me to do. But resisting it makes it worse. So we engage, even when it's the discord, the disharmony, and the pain. Engage it. But engage it from a higher level of consciousness, where you know that you are not. The pain is not all that you are. Because see, when we break up from a relationship, or a family member makes their transition, or a doctor gives us a diagnosis or prognosis of whatever, sometimes we take it on as if that's all that we are. I am the one whose mother died. I am the one who the doctor just said I have 6 months to live. And we become, I have no more money. I am the one who is now broke. I become that thing. Yeah, no. This anniversary is the reminder that for how many years? 37. This and keynote is that prior to, because what did the beloved say? Prior to the charter actually being given on paper, this ministry existed. So even more than 37 years, there has been a beacon of light in this community, in this country, to demonstrate what truth is, what light is, what love is. And all of you are a part of that. That means on some level, you have engaged. On some level, you have committed enough to come here on Sunday morning, to show up on Wednesdays, to show up on other days of the week, whether it's for choir rehearsal, whether it's for prayer, whether it's for any of the number of things that happen here. You have agreed. Now the thing is, because in the United States of America, I run into a lot of people who do this. I'm not saying you do, because I know you don't, because you are the enlightened ones. But I'm just using it as an example. There are many folks, because I used to be a fundamental Christian. We come to church on Sunday, and we put the halo on, pull little strings of light comes on, and we strut and we walk because we know we're holy. We know we're good. It's good morning, God be with you. We go about our business. And then church is done. Click, the light comes off, the halo goes back in the closet, and we go about our business. So we are Sunday Christian. And the funny thing is, I'm noticing in some of the CSLs, in some of the unities, back in, I'm running into more and more people who are doing that with this teaching. That on Sunday, we believe in God, the living Spirit Almighty. We believe that heaven is within and we experience it. We believe in the direct revelation of truth. But yes, we believe. And as soon as we get in our cars and drive, we start, I can't, I'll never be able to, etc., etc., etc. Today is a great invitation to be able to say, I'm going to recommit. You know, have you ever heard of anybody, or you may have, you've been married for a while and you choose to have a marriage ceremony again, like we're going to recommit our vows. We're going to do this again. Just to restate that for 20 years, 30 years, we've been married for 40 years, we've been married for 80 years, I ain't trying. We've been married for a long time, and it's time to recommit. Just to let you know that over this time, my love for you has, if anything, grown. And I just want to, in front of family and friends, let them and let you know how much I'm committed to you. What if today is that invitation for this entire community to recommit, to let this community know that I believe in the mission, that I believe in the vision of this beautiful center, that I believe in what it is giving me and affording me the ability to be, do, and have. And then as I walk my walk, as I go out in the world, out there, I don't need to have anything on me that says that I am from or that I go to the temple of life. Because if I go to market, if I go wherever and I'm walking and I'm, people should be able to see and feel something is different about me. Something is different about you. And they're like, wait a minute, every time I see her, she's like really joy-filled. And she told me last week that this and this and this and this happened. She shouldn't be happy, but she is. Why? And people will come up and ask. People will say, something about your, I've seen you smile many times, but something about the way you smiled at me today when you inserted your card to make this purchase, it lit me up. What, how did you do that? And they'll ask, and you'll say, temple of life. Stop by and visit. You will never be the same. That every person that sees you and everyone that you see sees this philosophy of love shining forth. That everyone you talk to and everyone that talks to you, everyone that you hear, everyone who hears you, hears words that vibrate with empowerment and authenticity. So that when you say good morning, their soul feels, that's God, I'm God, I love you. And all you did was said good morning. But they feel it. That everything and everyone you touch, and everything and everyone that touches you, radiates and resonates. Like, anybody in here ever felt or had the experience of a cold? And there's a thing with, like, you cover it because you don't want to spread the contagion. But check this out. This philosophy is teaching, sneeze on everybody. Like, spread it. Be contagious with that thing called light. Be contagious with that thing called love. Be contagious with that thing called authenticity. Be contagious with that thing called Christ consciousness. So that everyone that sees you, hears you, touches you, knows that they are loved. And all you did was bought a lint roll. All you did was bought three patties. But there was something in the mix. So I want to read something for you. So, let's go with this one. Ernest Holmes says in Creative Mind, in the infinity of mind, which is the principle of all metaphysics and all life, there is nothing but mind and that which mind does. That is all there is in the universe. That is all there ever will, was, or ever will be. The mind is acted upon by our thought. And so our thought becomes the law of our lives. It is just as much a law in our lives as God's thought is in the larger life of the universe. The manner in which we think, do we think of ourselves as life? Do we think of ourselves as love? Do we think of how much we have to be grateful for? If our thoughts become the law that shows up in our lives, are we living, moving, and breathing and speaking in a way that is demonstrating, I know that this vibration that is coming out of my mouth has power? To the degree that I am not going to say things, you have the power of life and death in your tongue. I'm not going to say things that are going to cause negative vibrations, life disaffirming vibrations to go out into the world. I am not going to contaminate any man, woman, or child with a vibration of what they can't do. I am not going to demonstrate or anything a vibration of what someone should do. What I said yesterday was a lot of people should on themselves. Stop. Stop judging and condemning. I am not going to speak that over my life or anyone else's life. And see, one thing we do is we think of being the embodiment of the universe in these forms. Love in these forms. Light in these forms. We think of it as too much. There's Jesus. That's different from me. There's other different, they're better, they're bigger, they're stronger, but then there's little old me. So anybody here familiar with Star Wars and So in The Empire Strikes Back, there's this scene where Yoda is instructing Luke and trying to raise this X-Wing fighter out of the swamp. And Luke is like, and it shakes and it quivers, but it doesn't, it doesn't rise. And Luke tells Yoda, it's too big. And he goes away. And Yoda's like, look, judge me by my size, do you? Because Yoda ain't been this big. As well you should not. For my ally is the Force. Pause. Did you know that George Lucas was influenced by the Science of Mind textbook? There's an article that was in the New York Times years ago when Star Wars first came out, and Tim and his son standing in front of a bookcase in his office, and prominently in the center of the bookcase is the Science of Mind textbook. So the Force, for him, is the Tao, is God, is the Source. So a powerful ally is the Force, my ally. Are we living and moving and having our being is knowing that our ally, the same thing that grows the grass, that beats our heart, is not just beating our heart, it is beating its heart as us. It is breathing us, breathing itself as us. Because there is no us and God. Paul said there is only one mind. Mind is all there is. So that mind being God being all there is, that mind is your mind. That mind is love-based, it is light-filled, and that mind is your mind now. Are we tapping into it? Are we ready to recommit to this new phase of thriving ministry? Knowing that every corner of this country can be, is being changed and transformed by your consciousness. So that when you see the news, you have the opportunity to change what you see. You have the opportunity to, in your consciousness, see light in all people, see love in all people, to know that is the truth of who and what you are. What if that's the invitation today on this amazing 37th anniversary? Let's pray. Ground this in truth. Simply allowing ourselves to breathe and to be breathed. Knowing that right here, right now, that which God is, that which Source is, that which is the Force, the universe, the one mind, the thing itself, is breathing itself as us. And knowing this truth, I begin with the end in mind. Amen. That God is all there is. Amen. That which God is love. Amen. That which God is love, is right here, right now, incarnating in, through, and as me, and as everyone in this room, everyone in this country, everyone on this planet and beyond. God is all there is. Yes, this is what I know. This is the truth. Amen, that I am grateful to know this. Amen, that I am grateful to know that all discord is already non-existent in the mind of God. Amen, that I know that which is in the mind of God is in my mind, for there is but one mind. Amen, that I know that one mind is the same mind of everyone in this room, this country, this planet, and beyond. Amen, that I know gratitude is what I am. That which is omnipresence, omniscience, and omnipotence is the truth of my being, as well as, because there cannot be multiple truths that are separate for individuals, but there is one truth, God is. That which God is, we are. Amen. That this gratitude places this word back into the law from whence it came. Because what I know is that these words were not the words of Raymond Anderson, but that these words